Jordan, just, yeah, stop, man. Let's take a break. You've worked hard. Just relax. Sit down. Yeah, right there. Perfect. And I don't know, open your mouth for no reason. Just, you know, to breathe, to breathe nicely. Welcome back, Deep Your VTV viewers. It's Chris Nichols here, and the day has finally come. I have an Olympus EM10-4 in my hands, yes indeed. You guys have been asking about this. Like, you know, we did do our best cameras under $1,000. Jordan picked this as his best video kit because it did give you a lot of interesting options, but I haven't really played with it as a photography camera. And there's actually a lot of interesting things about this camera. I mean, first off, this is one of those cameras that's designed by the manufacturer to kind of be aimed at the smartphone user that wants to move up to a more creative camera. Now, I'm no marketing major, but I don't really think that's a big part of the market. I don't think a lot of people have a smartphone and want to move up to a camera, but I certainly think that there's a lot of people who are on a budget and want to do a creative camera without breaking the bank, and this certainly qualifies. When you look at this entry-level camera compared to some of the other entry-level cameras on the market, which are APS-C, and you look at the stats and the specs and stuff, on paper, this camera maybe doesn't do very well. You might be wondering, why would I purchase this? Well, I want to approach the video today looking at it as, are there features on this camera that are compelling that maybe do make it the right choice for somebody who's just getting into photography on a limited budget? Hopefully we'll find that out today. I might survive. Oh, I'm gonna make it. Now I wanna talk about the body design first, because this could be a very compelling reason to get this camera. It is honestly quite nice to look at from a distance. And what I mean by that is, up close, you do notice it's kind of plasticky nature. I mean, this is not a weather sealed camera at all or anything like that, but none of them are in this range. But it does have a very classic look. It has a nice feel, and it's a very lightweight camera with an excellent grip. I like that because it means I can hold larger lenses on here if I want and not feel like they're gonna fall out of my hand. And when I am just going around for the day, it's a very compact, pocketable package. Now, normally the EM10 Mark IV is kitted with the 12-42 power zoom. It's like a pancake lens almost, very compact, but we don't have it with us. So I'm using a 12-45 f/4, more expensive, but you know, you work with the gear that you've got. I've also got a nicer telephoto as well, but the fact is you can put all the Panasonic and Olympus Micro Four Thirds lenses on a body like this in the future. And again, that grip does make it very manageable. Okay, so we've got a great grip and a very handsome camera, but what about actual controls? Well, first off, the greatest thing about this camera is the control dials themselves. Dual dials that fit perfectly when you hold the camera and honestly feel really high quality. I even like the mode dial. It's nice and high, easy to turn, and although there's no lock, it does have a very solid click stop. Now on the back panel, we do have a really nice joypad. It's actually quite sexy looking, actually much sexier looking than you find on a lot of higher end cameras. It's working well. Of course, you got our super control panel by hitting the OK button in the middle of that. You are gonna rely on that a lot though, because honestly, you don't have a lot of customization on this camera. I can customize the digital converter button on the top, which just crops in on your photo. You lose a bunch of resolution, that's garbage. And I can also customize the movie record button as well as the AEL AFL button. However, you're pretty limited in what you can actually customize it for. Most of the settings are things like peaking or magnify, which are great for video use, but not really something that we use for photography very often. Now I can customize the AEL AFL button to do back button focusing, which is something I really like to do, but unfortunately it's in an absolutely horrible place. You got to put your thumb up on the right side of the grip. It doesn't feel very secure anymore. It's not comfortable to press, but unfortunately right here where it should be, well, there's just no space to do that because the grip kind of curves right into the body and then the panel's in the way. So that is going to be unfortunate. Now for people that are starting out, you probably don't need a lot of customization anyways, but if you did like to set up the camera more to your own taste, this isn't really the greatest one for that. So Jordan says I have to do my requisite puddle photo. So here we go. I found one here for you guys. And I do like something about this back panel. So first off, I'm going to mention that you can rotate this vertically to even do your own selfies. And handheld, that's great. It works fine. But of course, this is a terrible position if you want to use it on a tripod. I mean, more than terrible, it's basically useless. But I do love that I actually get a really nice waist level view with the back panel here. So I don't have to lie down in this muck and I can get this puddle shot that I know you guys all want. Now the displays on the EM10 Mark IV, nothing to write home about, but absolutely typical for cameras in this price range. You get a back panel, which is just over a million dots, touchscreen. The EVF is quite nice. I mean, it's a 2.36 million dot EVF, very standard in this range. It's an OLED though, and it's quite sharp and quite clear as these EVFs go. And it is worth pointing out that the A6100's EVF is actually quite a bit lower resolution in this price range. So one of the biggest upgrades you're going to find over the original EM10 Mark III, the camera that came before this, is now we have a 20 megapixel sensor. This is the same sensor you find in the EM5 Mark III. I happen to like Micro Four Thirds sensors. I mean, yes, if you look at an APS-C sensor and many of the similarly priced counterparts, they do give you more megapixels. They do tend to punch a little bit higher, more dynamic range and low light performance. But especially at this price point where you're looking at enthusiasts buying these cameras, you're shooting for your own pleasure, you're gonna like the image quality that you get out of it. Decent dynamic range, still absolutely usable in lower light situations, and I think, you know, certainly a good option compared to smartphones. Now it's time to talk about IBIS, in-body image stabilization, because if there was ever a reason to take this camera over the competition, IBIS is it. Now a lot of cameras will have lens stabilizers, optical stabilizers built into the lens, but this one has it built into the body. And the beauty of that is no matter what lens I put on this camera, I have image stabilization. Now, as I alluded to earlier, you can have the greatest sensor on the planet, but if shaky hands and slow shutter speeds are messing up your pictures, it's not gonna do you any good. So this does give me that nice stability. It's not as high as their top of the line IBIS systems, but 4.5 stops of stabilization is still a huge benefit. If I'm trying to handhold this camera and try to squeeze off sharp pictures and light levels are getting low and shutter speeds are getting slow, this is gonna help me out a lot, and that's a big advantage. Okay, so what if you want to use this camera to do some sports and action and wildlife? Well, if you're doing family stuff, casual shooting, the fact that this camera only shoots 5 frames per second in mechanical shutter mode isn't going to be that big a deal. But if you want to do something more intense, this camera's going to lag behind the competition. Many other cameras will push 7 or 8 frames per second or even faster. However, there is a big upside here. This camera is able to shoot 40 RAW plus high quality JPEGs in a row before it slowed down. That means we've got a decent sized buffer in this camera, but also it's thanks to the fact that we've got a very fast UHS 2 SD card slot built into this camera. Now I'm using an appropriately fast card and it clears out that buffer really quick, and I'm ready to shoot another 40 frame burst very quickly. If you're just shooting JPEGs or just shooting RAWs, you'll get even more. Now, battery life is also higher than a lot of the competition here. That's a nice bonus. And this is now able to charge through the USB port. However, it is the first gen style of charging where you can't use PD chargers to charge it. That means your charging times are often 5 or 6 hours to charge up a battery. That's basically an overnight situation. And unfortunately, they don't give you an external charger when you buy the camera. That's another purchase. So let me talk about autofocus now that I'm surrounded by this idyllic snowfall in April. This is what we call third winter in Calgary. Now the EM10 Mark IV's autofocus, unfortunately, this is where the lower price point hurts us a little bit, because it's a contrast only autofocusing system. Now contrast detect autofocusing systems are quite accurate, especially if you're doing still life, single point focus, that kind of stuff. But if I'm trying to track moving subjects, this is where the competition does better. Canon with its dual pixel systems, Sony and Fuji with hybrid autofocusing systems, they just have a better opportunity to track moving subjects, stay on to the right subject, and are a bit more tenacious when it comes to continuous focusing. Now, if you have a subject running straight towards you or away from you, the camera's actually gonna do a pretty good job. It's when you have erratic movement, you know, you're trying to do something like wildlife or sports, this is where the hybrid autofocus systems do a much better job of tracking moving subjects and staying on them tenaciously. The other problem is when you are using a contrast detect system and you're focusing on something continuously, the camera's constantly doing this back and forth pulsing in and out of focus. Now, it doesn't mean you're gonna be out of focus, but you don't have the confidence where the camera's focusing smoothly and tracking something smoothly. And so long story short, I think if I was shooting any sports or wildlife, I would feel that I've got a disadvantage here with this camera compared to the competition. If I was shooting kids, pets, still life landscape portraits, I think I'd do okay. Okay, so now it's time to go over to Jordan. He's gonna talk about this camera as a video platform.
Jordan here to talk about the video features of the EM10 IV, and as Chris mentioned earlier, I did pick it as my top camera for under $1,000. Now bear in mind, that's also so I could afford a lens with it. But there's a few reasons for that. First of all, the 4K quality is really nice on this camera, and it actually has less of a crop than the much more expensive Panasonic G95, even though Panasonic's kind of known for video. The other real advantage to this is we get the IBIS system in it, which is very rare at this price, and it's extremely useful in video. If you want to just grab a small light camera and get stable footage, this is a great choice. It's not quite as good as some of the new, more expensive professional Olympus bodies, but it's still very, very capable. I also really like the color in the natural profile that comes off this. It's not going to give you a ton of room to grade, but it's just a very pleasing look right out of camera, which is exactly what you want with a consumer camera like this. Now, there are a few issues with this camera. The most important one is there's no mic jack. So right now I'm using a Zoom H1 to record my audio. But if you're planning to record a lot of sound into camera, then honestly, this isn't going to be the best choice for you. The other real limitation for more casual shooters is this is using contrast detect autofocus, not the hybrid systems used in the more expensive Olympus bodies, but I was actually fairly impressed. I mean, I wouldn't use this for following quickly moving action like kids or animals running around, but for things like this, it's not fluttering like we'd see with a lot of the Panasonic bodies, and I do think you can rely on it from time to time. If not, the manual focus is really nice on this. But if you're looking for a small, light, inexpensive video camera that's going to give you access to a whole pile of Micro Four Thirds lenses, this is a great choice.
So unfortunately, I don't think the M10 Mark IV is a versatile camera that can suit many different kinds of photographers and photography. I think it's got a lot of strengths, but it also has a lot of weaknesses, and it really comes down to the kind of person that you are and the stuff that you want to shoot. You know, for example, a lot of people crap on the Micro Four Thirds sensor, but really, I find the shutter on here is very smooth. Having the IBIS in there is a big advantage, and it means that if I'm shooting still life, I don't have to crank my ISO up very high. I can keep it a little bit lower. I'll let my shutter speeds go a little bit slower, and because it's such a nice platform to shoot handheld, I still get sharp pictures. But that'll change if things start to move. If we talk about action and movement, IBIS doesn't help you out there. You know, that's where I need faster shutter speeds. That's where I need to be able to crank my ISO higher and still get better image quality. And I think that's where the other APS-C cameras with their more sophisticated autofocusing systems do a better job. I do think the autofocus is going to be another big factor that's going to determine whether this camera works for you. I love it for still life. You know, I love it for just classic point, lock, recompose shooting. But if I want to do any sort of moving subjects or wildlife or sports, I just really think that the cameras with hybrid AF do better. I mean, case in point, the Sony a6100. I mean, its autofocusing with that real-time tracking is so easy to use and so effective. And I think, honestly, very helpful for many different kinds of photographers out there. And I would rather have that. But at the same token, that Sony a6100 has a terrible EVF, it's an ugly body, and it just doesn't have any soul. Whereas this camera is beautiful, nice to hold, and has a good control structure layout. Would I buy the M10 Mark IV for myself? No, personally I wouldn't. You know, I like having a more sophisticated autofocusing system. I definitely like to have a proper AF on button in the back in the right position. And so this camera doesn't suit all the kinds of photography that I want it to tackle. But who is it for? I mean, I think if you're doing landscapes and still lifes and you just want like a lightweight, attractive looking travel cam that you can easily transport, this would be a great choice. I think if you like to wander on the streets and, you know, just do the sort of classic focus, recompose and shoot kind of stuff, maybe slow things down a little bit, I think this would be a great thing as well. And if you do want to use really cute small prime lenses and shoot in lower light situations and rely on that IBIS, I think this would also be a fantastic platform for you. Hopefully this all helps you decide whether this suits what you guys want to do with it. Do check out our sample gallery at deepyourview.com. There will be links below. But otherwise, thank you guys for joining us for another episode of Deep Your View TV.